Thank you very much and good morning everybody. I would like to start by thanking Jürgen Ehm and Dominique Franco for I am going to talk about a startup for drug and vaccine development. I've been working as a clinician at Assistance Publique Hôpitaux de Paris and as head of a research team at INSERM on liver diseases during 15 years and then in the pharmaceutical industry during more than 20 years in various R&D management positions in charge of several reorganization projects, including spin-off and startup creation. And I am currently the chairman of the Project Evaluation Committee of Medicine Paris Région. Medicine is a 500-member organization which brings together research and hospital academic institutions, and among them, by the way, Institut Pasteur, large companies and small and medium-sized companies, SMEs, with an objective of fostering innovation and creating economical value. Emerging 80% of medicine SMEs are small companies, are startups, by the way, with employees less than 10 with employees. Medicine activity is covering the whole spectrum of health innovation, medtech, biotech, digital health, and services. Some key figures about medicine. From the beginning, Medicine has evaluated more than 1,600 projects, of which 340 were supported and funded, corresponding to more than 700 million euros of public funding and nearly 2 billion euros of investment. I would like to start by what I call the landscape. And there has been a major paradigm shift over the past 30 years. And this is on the two slides, the two next slides. Emerging pharma companies, which are in fact small pharma companies, small biotech companies, that is companies which spend less than $200 million in R&D, now account for more than 70% of the total R&D late-stage development pipeline. Also, almost two-thirds of new drugs, which are put on the market here on this slide, are initially discovered by emerging companies, while large pharma only discover a quarter of them. So these are the 2018 figures. If you compare to 2010, you can see that this proportion is clearly increasing. So this means that startups and small biotechs are now clearly the innovation engine of the pharmaceutical and vaccine industry. And of course, one of the questions is why this is happening. And I see several reasons. The first one is that, of course, small biotech startups are often created by researchers who made the original scientific and technological discovery, which means that there is, from the very beginning in the company, a lot of scientific and technological knowledge. It's created most of the time by highly motivated individuals with strong affinity, which usually share a common vision, and this is clearly leading to a very strong dynamic. Of course, there is financial risk, which can be a major incentive, sort of succeed or perish paradigm. What is very interesting is that it is usually considered that small organizations are much more inventive and disruptive than big ones, and there is an interesting study which has been published in Nature 2 years ago, which show that there is in fact an inverse relationship on the size of the team and its ability to deliver disruptive innovation. Small organizations are much more agile. They have a stronger dynamic capability in a changing environment, which is the case in the scientific environment, of course. They are much more focused, usually on one or two products. And of course, success can lead to very high reward and recognition. Now, I would like to talk about startups carrying out drug and vaccine development project and discuss with you what I see as key success factor. And I will start by the project. The starting point of a startup is really the project. And the question to be addressed is the following. It's really how to transform a scientific innovation into a product that will be purchased and which can be translated into building a value proposal. And in my experience, a poor value proposal is the most important reason for project failure and therefore startup failure. So what does this mean? A value proposal is built by combining three components. The first one is the circle in blue. It's about technology. It's about the scientific innovation itself. And it's in fact what you are supposed to do the best. And there are three keywords here. One is innovation. In innovation, you have the idea of novelty. So there need to be a novelty. This has to be built on scientific and technical excellence, meaning at least state of the art or even above. And of course, you need a very strong IP protection and also a freedom to operate. I'm not the time to cover this, but this is, of course, very important. Today, we are talking about drug and vaccines, but it's important to have in mind that besides startups which are developing drugs and vaccines, there are many other business opportunities related to services or to technologies supporting the R&D process. For example, you have companies which are involved in drug design, structural biology, in vector development, in the drug delivery technology, in process development or in manufacturing. All of these are important and can lead to very profitable businesses. Second circle in red is about market and customer need. And this is probably the one which is the most difficult to catch when you are a scientist, but it is probably the most important. If you want to succeed, you will have to answer the following question. Why someone will buy my product or request a service? And there are many examples of products, drugs, devices, diagnostic tests, even e-health solutions, based on really on cutting-edge science or technology that have been approved by regulatory agencies, but are never used or never prescribed. Very important question that you will have to address are, what is the medical need or the technical need that I am targeting with my product? What is the expected benefit of my product? And ultimately, why this product will be adopted by the consumer or by patient? In other words, building a value proposal means that you are not deciding. It is the consumer who decides. And the question is, what value do I bring to the patient, to the prescriber, or to the consumer? Of course, the efficacy of a drug is a way to create value, but this value can be significantly leveraged, increased by if you tackle, for example, a rare disease, or a severe disease, or if your product is a disease modifier, which means that you are going to significantly change the course of a disease. Of course, if it is highly potent and more potent than the competitors, and also, not the least, if you are marketing your drug with a companion diagnostic test, which allow you to predict what's going to be the subgroup of patients in which the drug is likely to be the most active. But besides efficacy, there are other dimensions that create value. For example, the safety of a product, its cost, and if you are developing a medical device or working on a process, the robustness of the device, its simplicity, the quality, the design, very important for a medical device, and the ease of use in general are very important dimensions to create value. To give you an example of a value proposal, this was the initial formulation of the project. We want to develop a new drug with an innovative mechanism of action in stroke. This is not the right formulation. The right formulation would be, we want to develop a new drug in stroke, which can be prescribed and given immediately after hospital admission. That is an emergency use, which means it's going to be an IV formulation. You will have to have it in pre-filled syringes, and it's going to be given concomitantly with a thrombolytic agent, which means that your product will need to be devoid of the course of an intracranial hemorrhagic risk. The third circle is about benchmark and differentiation in green. You will have to position yourself in relation to your competitors. This is absolutely mandatory, and strangely enough, not very often lacking in the project we are reviewing. You have always competitors, either in the development phase or product already on the market. This slide are represented the number of companies working on similar therapeutic targets. In dark blue, it's only one company and one target, but as you can see, in most of the cases, you have more than one company working on a target. In yellow, it's more than five. Combining these three circles is absolutely necessary to build the value proposal and to be able to answer the following question, why the customer is going to buy my product. And for a researcher, this implies a major change in mindset. Your work is not going to be the same. The main focus is not going to be science, but it's going to be business. And this is a very big difference. So why building a value proposal is the most important prerequisite when you are considering creating a startup, because it is the most important criteria for approval of the product by regulatory agencies, for pricing when you are going to deal with reimbursement with the payers, and ultimately adoption by prescriptors and patients. The second reason, which is not the less important, this has to be set up really at the start of the project, because the main objective of your development strategy is going to be demonstrate the value of your product, which means that you will have to use specific preclinical models to demonstrate the activity, specific and relevant comparators, a relevant patient population, and of course, specific trial endpoints in line with the value that you want to demonstrate, and also biomarkers. Let's talk about the project development strategy. Schematically, the full R&D development process can be divided into four parts. The first part is really the research part. And for a drug, for example, it's target, the identification of the target and its validation, which is followed by a preclinical part where you are identifying leads and drug candidates, which is followed by the clinical development part. You are testing the drug in patients, and ultimately the filing, approval, marketing part, followed by the adoption of your product by physician and by patient. Developing a drug is an exceptionally long, risky, and costly process, I have to say, which requires large diversity of skills and resources. And in terms of duration, it's going to be something like 10, 15 years. And those numbers have not changed over, I would say, 10, 20 years. They are still the same. In terms of probability of success, if you want to go from preclinical to clinical, it's going to be approximately 50% chance of success. One out of two compounds is going to fail. And in the clinical development part, it's around 10% probability of success, which means that of 10 compounds entering into the clinic, only one will be marketed. In terms of development cost, the cost to develop a product is somewhere between 80 and 150 million euro or dollars. It's not a big difference, but just to give you an idea of the figures we are talking about. Sometimes I hear researchers saying we want to advance our project as far as possible. In fact, the question that should be answered is, let's see what is the best strategy to market this drug and this vaccine. And in fact, you will have to find the best compromise between, on one hand, the value that you create when you are progressing your project and going in the proof of concept study, and your ability and resources to move the project forward. There are several technology transfer strategies, and I have not the time to go through all of them, but one of them obviously is the creation of a startup. So why creating a startup? One of the main reasons is that large companies are often reluctant to embark on disruptive projects before a minimal level of proof of concept. And this is probably one of the most important reasons why we are creating startups. I have to say that in my professional life, I have seen this very often. Large companies don't like too much to have too risky projects. They are waiting to have really the full proof of concept before eventually embarking on a project. The other reason is really that creating a startup speed up the innovation and development process, give you freedom for your originating institution. You have, as I mentioned earlier, all the expertise, the scientific expertise to transition from research to development. You will have a dedicated staff focused on one project. And very importantly, you will have access to public and private funding. And not last but not the least, the biotech spirit, which creates a lot of team dynamic. The first scenario when you are creating a startup is to grow, is the growth of the startup, which becomes a bigger biotech company by organic growth and will be able to complete the whole development cycle. Company growth may be fueled by acquisition or by listing the company on the stock by following an IPO. And if we look, for example, development of the COVID-19 vaccine, a good example is Moderna. But this implies that you will be able to bring all the skills and the experience which are necessary to complete the whole development. And if you look at the executive committee of Moderna, you'll see that these guys really have significant industry and business experience. The second scenario is the creation of a startup that will grow up to the clinical proof of concept and then will license out, co-develop, eventually will be acquired by a bigger company that will complete the end of the development program, filing, manufacturing, and commercialization. And clearly, this is currently one of the most frequent scenarios, one of the frequent models, which correspond to what is usually called the open innovation concept. The examples, if you look at the COVID-19 vaccine story, of course, is the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine, which is a collaboration between BioNTech and Pfizer. But there are many other examples of acquisition that led to major breakthrough drugs, for example, ivacaftor in cystic fibrosis, ipilimumab and anti-CTLA-4 in oncology, or pembrolizumab and anti-PD-1 in oncology, or sofosbuvir for hepatitis C. All these really breakthrough drugs resulted from the acquisition of a small company by a bigger one. The third scenario does not imply the creation of a startup. It is the full development by an existing company, a big pharma or biotech, from the drug discovery stage. This may result from a transfer, from an IP transfer agreement between the academic institution and the company, or is not linked to any IP agreement because the research was done internally within the company from the very beginning. This has been the traditional model in the pharma industry for many decades, but as I mentioned earlier, it's now losing momentum. One of the big advantages is that big pharma provide an integrated organization covering the whole value chain with large financial resources, but there are risks. There is a so-called non-inventor syndrome, which means that teams in the company are usually relatively skeptical when a discovery has not been done in the company, which can lead to a sort of slowing of the development of the project. But more importantly, the risk is that the project may be no more considered as a priority because the strategy of the company is going to change, which may lead to a lot of stop and go. Of course, examples of such a strategy are the AstraZeneca-Oxford collaboration or the Johnson & Johnson Janssen vaccine, which was fully developed from the very beginning within the company. Now, I would like to say a few words about financial issues. I am sometimes hearing researchers saying financial and economical issues are not my cup of tea. Well, I can tell you, if this is the case, it's better not to embark on the adventure. This slide shows you a typical financial cycle of a biotech, which comprises first an R&D expenditure phase here, followed by a revenue phase when the product is on the market, but with an NPV, which is usually not reached before several years. The hard reality is that to move a project forward, you will need several rounds of fundraising, and this slide shows you gives you a flavor of the typical fundraising range that are necessary to go to market. And as you can see, for example, at the very beginning, you would need several millions. In the preclinical part, something between 5 and 20. Early clinical studies, 25 to 50. And later on, up to marketing, you will need something like $50 to $100 million. Now, the good news is that VC investment in biotech is growing all over the world. And here you have the figure between 2010 and 2019. And this includes Europe. And as you can see, for example, from 2010 to 2019, the available venture capital has tripled in EU to from 1 to 3 to 2 billion, thanks to the emergence of bigger and stronger European VC fund. But I have to say that despite this positive dynamics, the financing gap with US biotech is growing. As you can see on this slide, they receive almost 3 to 4 times as much as private funding as their European counterpart do. So now most experts agree that sufficient financing is now available for early stage round, but there is a very significant gap in the late stage round or for the IPO. So unfortunately, many European biotech tend to look more and more to the US for growth capital. Raising money is not an easy task. Indeed, it is usually considered that most venture capitalists fund fewer than 1% of the deals that they review. So be prepared for this. But this is why non-dilutive funding is interesting. Non-dilutive funding is financing where you don't have to resort to selling a share of your startup. So you are not diluting your equity. And non-dilutive funding include government grants and industry partnership. And here on this slide, you have examples of European or government grants or even local regional grants here in France through BPI France or Région Île-de-France, which can provide you very significant funding, non-dilutive funding, and which are very interesting to keep in mind. One is about the success rate of biotech startups. And this data from a recent paper published in Nature Biotechnology, and really I encourage you to read this very interesting paper, where they study the fate of nearly 500 startups created by spin-off or licensing out from the top 50 patent-producing US universities. universities between 1980 and 2013. And as you can see, they show that 23% of the companies were acquired or went public through an IPO, 30% were still in business, and 57% had disappeared. An interesting finding of this analysis is that a key factor for success is the leverage effect of the geographical location. And, you know, they look, for example, on 500 companies, some of them start in a cluster, while others did not start in a biocluster. And if you look at the success rate, when the companies start in a big biocluster, the probability of success is 50%. While you are not starting in a big biocluster, it's 20%. Biocluster, like the one of Paris and its region, include most public and private players involved in health innovation, which are in close proximity, which contribute to a strong ecosystem. And clearly, to be within such a network facilitates the transfer of new knowledge, the contact with companies, with investors, etc., and is a key success factor for startups. So this is my last slide. I cannot finish this presentation without putting the picture of the two founders of Ganymede, which became BioNTech, on the left, Unger Sahin, and on the right, Özlem Türeci, who made it possible to achieve this absolutely incredible feat of developing the SARS-CoV-2 vaccine in 1 year with the new mRNA technology. And clearly, a key driver for success was the rapid decision they took to set up a dedicated team in January 2020, as soon as the virus sequence was published. And this is, for me, one of the best examples of scientists who were able to develop their company while keeping the startup spirit intact, that is, combining scientific excellence, a commitment to patients, flexibility, reactivity, and dynamism. And I will terminate on this. I thank you very much for your attention.